In my previous video, I talked briefly about tiered caching, a practice of combining slow spinning disks and fast SSDs into one storage array to basically get the best of both worlds. The relatively low price per gigabyte of the hard drives and the high speed and low power consumption of the SSDs. The idea is to write all data to the SSDs first, keep it there until the SSDs fill up, and then move the files that haven't been accessed in a while to the hard drive array, say once a week. That way you get fast writes because you're not actually writing to the hard drives themselves, and fast reads for the data that you actually access often, since files get moved to the hard drive array based on access time. Now of course you can always build an all-flash NAS or buy something like LumaForge Jellyfish if you're swimming in cash, but tiered caching is an amazing and relatively budget-friendly way to make your NAS way faster, quieter, and more power efficient without compromising on the storage capacity. But before you even start thinking about putting SSDs into your NAS, you're probably gonna have to upgrade your networking. What? Networking? Why? Well, thing is, the majority of you guys and gals probably have a 1 gigabit LAN link to your NAS. The maximum theoretical speed of a gigabit connection is around 125 megabits, which isn't going to be enough to fully saturate a hard drive, let alone an SSD. So in order to really take advantage of an SSD cache, you will need to upgrade your networking. If you already have a 2.5 gigabit or a 10 gigabit connection to your NAS, feel free to skip this segment. The good news is 2.5 gigabit gear has been getting cheaper and more common, and if you have a relatively new desktop PC, it might even have a 2.5 gigabit card installed in it. 2.5 gigabit brings us from 125 megabyte per second to 312. Sure, it's still not going to saturate our SATA SSDs, but it's also twice the speed of a 1 gigabit link, which is a major upgrade. If you only have one or two machines connected to your NAS at a time, don't do any data intensive stuff such as 4K video editing, and just want to access your files a bit faster, this should be more than enough. Unlike 10 gigabit, with 2.5 gigabit you can also utilize your existing Cat5e, Cat6 or Cat6e cables and wiring, which could save you a lot of money. If either your server or your desktop PC doesn't have a 2.5 gigabit network adapter, you can always buy one of these for as little as 25 euros online. Just make sure that the adapter you buy has decent Linux drivers and good reviews, you know, the usual. For laptops, you can get one of these 2.5 gigabit USB dongles. Sure, it's not a perfect solution since USB NICs have a tendency to be flaky, but as long as you get one from a reputable brand with good reviews, you should be good to go. Last but not least, if you want to connect multiple computers to your NAS, or just don't want to mess around with DHCP or static IPs, you'll also need a 2.5 gigabit switch. This unmanaged switch from QNAP is a pretty good entry-level model and should get you up and running pretty quickly. So let's do some napkin math. In the worst case scenario, you'll need two 2.5 gig PCIe cards, two Cat6 cables, let's get a pack of 5 just in case, and a 2.5 gig switch. All of that will set you back around 171 euros. However, if you want to get even more speed out of your NAS, the next step is 10 gig. Just like the 2.5 gig NICs, 10 gigabit networking adapters are also relatively cheap. For example, this Mellanox Connect X3, which is the one I use in my NAS, is only 70 bucks. So that's all fine and well, but once you start actually looking into connecting those two network adapters together, things start getting complicated. Fiber? DAC? RJ45? And what's this thing? What do I go with? Well, good news is, you probably don't need to rewire your entire house for 10 gigabit. Unless you're running a company with dozens of video editors like Linus here, you probably only need to connect one or two machines to your NAS via the 10 gigabit connection. The rest of your devices can still use 1 or 2.5 gig. Seriously, your Wi-Fi access point or your Raspberry Pi don't need a 10 gig uplink. Yet. So, what do you go with? Well, if all of your computers are relatively close to each other, I'd go with DAC, or Direct Attached Copper Cables. Those can be as long as 7 meters and don't require any additional gear. Just plug in the cable on both ends and you're all set. The cables themselves might seem pretty expensive compared to Cat6 cables, but you also won't need to buy transceivers to connect them to your SFE Plus switch, and 10 gig transceivers can get very pricey. If your computers are further away from each other than 7 meters, you'll need to use fiber or RJ45. If your house is already wired for at least Cat6a, then RJ45 is an obvious choice. With RJ45 cables, you're either going to need to use an SFE Plus switch and the RJ45 transceivers, or just get 10 gig RJ45 PCIe cards and a 10 gig RJ45 switch. Beware that 10 gig RJ45 switches and network cards tend to get hotter and consume way more power. and the same goes for RJ45 SFP Plus transceivers. Investing into the RJ45 gear will also lock you into only being able to use RJ45, so if you change your mind and decide to switch to DAC or fiber, you'll have to get a new switch and a new pair of PCIe adapters. So honestly, if your NAS and your main machine are in the same room, just go with a DAC cable. For the switch, I recommend this Microtik 4-port SFP Plus switch. They're relatively cheap, super reliable, and can be powered off of PoE. You could, of course, connect the computers to each other directly and save in the switch, but then you have to set up DHCP on your NAS and that can be annoying, whereas with a switch it's just plug and play. But you can try it that way first and just buy the switch later if you decide to expand. So the price in the same worst case scenario, two NICs, two cables, and a switch, adds up to around 333 euros. As you can see, 10 gig is definitely not as budget friendly as 2.5 gig, so I can only really recommend it if you do video editing or some other work that requires fast data transfers. With 10 gig, you can go as fast as 1.25 gigabyte per second, which means that you can kind of take advantage of the faster PCIe SSDs for your cache. 1.25 gigabyte per second is faster than 500 megabyte per second, but slower than the full speed of most NVMe SSDs. Sorry, but I'm not gonna talk about 20, 40, and 80 gig networking in this video, because 1, you probably don't need that much speed anyway, and 2, this video is already long enough as it is. Let's finally talk about storage. So what kind of SSDs do you go with, SATA or NVMe? These days, there isn't really much difference between SATA and NVMe SSDs in terms of price. Take a look at these two WD Red SSDs. Despite the NVMe version being almost 7 times faster, it's only about 3 euros more expensive. So, since there's no difference, you should just go with the faster NVMe drives, right? Well, not so fast. First of all, NVMe drives are usually hotter and more power hungry than their SATA counterparts, which is fine because they're also way faster and that's just the price you have to pay for that extra speed. But like we've already established, even with a 10 gig uplink, you won't quite be able to take full advantage of that speed, so I wouldn't really choose an NVMe drive just because it's faster. Second, depending on your motherboard, you might have a limited amount of slots and PCIe lanes. My server motherboard has exactly 1 NVMe slot, and yours might even have 0. You can turn any PCIe slot into like 16 SATA slots with something like this as media card, but in order to connect multiple NVMe drives to one PCIe slot, you're going to need a motherboard that supports PCIe bifurcation. And even then, you'll get 4 NVMe slots max with 1 PCIe X16 slot. In my opinion, SATA SSDs are a much more reasonable way to go. You can get a SATA adapter or an HBA card with as much as 22 SATA ports for relatively cheap. And SATA SSDs also have a lower power consumption than the NVMe, so being the power efficiency freak that I am, I went with SATA. I reached out to Western Digital and they sent me not 1, not 2, not 3, but 4 of their 2TB WD Red SSDs. The WD Red lineup has recently celebrated its 10 years anniversary, and just like their hard drives, the WD Red SSDs are also a very solid and reliable storage option for home NAS. These SSDs come with a 5-year limited warranty, and are also rated for up to 2500TB written, whereas a typical consumer-grade SSD of a similar capacity is rated for about 1000TB written. So thank you Western Digital for sponsoring this video and sending over the drives. And now, let's get back to the video. In order to use them in my Supermicro SCC833 rack mount case, I also had to buy 4 of those 2.5 to 3.5 adapters from Orico. Since I wanted to put the SSDs in hot swap bays, I needed to make sure that the adapters actually make the SATA connectors on 2.5 inch drives line up with where they will be on a 3.5 inch drive, and that's surprisingly hard to find. Of course, you don't need to buy 4 2TB SSDs yourself if you want to set up an SSD cache. You can start with a couple of 1TB drives at first, and then expand your array if you feel like it's not enough. Or can you? Well, that would depend on the kind of file system that you choose. And here we have basically 3 choices: BTRFS, ZFS, and Mergerfs, which isn't really a file system, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. BTRFS, and yes, I'm going to call it BTRFS and not BTRFS, has an advantage of being flexible. You can add new drives after the fact, use mixed size drives, switch between different RAID modes without losing any data, at least in theory, and so on. The problem is, unless you want to lose all of your data, you're probably gonna have to sacrifice half the capacity of your drives. Here's a small refresher on different RAID modes, or at least the ones that are still somewhat relevant today. RAID 1 is when you take 2 drives and write the same data on both of them. Basically, the 2 drives become an identical copy of each other, and you can lose one drive and still keep all of your data. RAID 10 or Stripe Mirror is when you do kind of the same thing but with multiple pairs of drives. With this mode you sacrifice half the capacity but get double the speed of your drives when reading or writing to them and can lose one drive in each pair before losing all of your data. However, if you lose both drives in a pair, you're SOL. RAID 5 is when you combine all of your drives into one big array and sacrifice the equivalent of the biggest drive in the array for parity data, which basically means that you can lose any one of your drives without losing the data. But in order to recover the data, you'll need to replace the drive and recalculate the parity, and that can take a long time. If you lose another drive during that process, you can say bye-bye to all of your data. Unless you use RAID 6, which is when you sacrifice the equivalent of two drives in your array to the gods of cosmic radiation. With RAID 6 you can lose up to 2 drives at the same time and still not lose any data. And finally, RAID 0. We don't talk about RAID 0. If you have 2 drives, you're obviously going to want to use RAID 1. But if you have more than 2, you would normally want to use RAID 5 so you don't lose that much capacity. Except in BTRFS, RAID 5 and 6 aren't very stable yet and generally aren't recommended for production use. Yes, the RAID 5-6 functionality has gotten way better and the BTRFS developers have been fixing a lot of bugs that used to cause data corruption and loss in earlier versions, but the documentation still refers to RAID 5-6 as experimental and doesn't recommend those modes for production use. So unless you like to live dangerously, the best option if you have an even number of drives and want to use BTRFS is RAID 10. With RAID 10 you lose half the capacity of your drives, but also don't risk falling victim to the BTRFS write hole bug. So what if you don't want to sacrifice half your drives to RAID 10? Well, in that case you can use ZFS. Just like BTRFS, ZFS has RAID 5/6 equivalent modes called RAID Z1 and RAID Z2 respectively, and those work pretty well. But unlike BTRFS, ZFS is notoriously rigid when it comes to storage arrays. You can only use same size drives, and the only way you can add more drives to an array is by destroying it and creating a new one. You can also replace every single drive in your array with a bigger one, but this is not super practical from a budget perspective. ZFS also comes with higher RAM requirements. You'll want at least 1 GB of RAM for every 1 TB of storage, and the more the better. That being said, ZFS is a much more mature file system than BTRFS. It also has a bigger community, which can get pretty elitist at times, but is still mostly friendly and helpful to beginners. And besides, the rebuilding the whole array from scratch thing might not be so dramatic with an SSD array, since you'll always have a larger hard drive array to copy the data over to. In general, your choice of a file system will most likely depend on your choice of an operating system. For example, if you use Unraid, you're going to want to stick with BTRFS, because that's what's officially supported for cache volumes. You can add ZFS support to Unraid by using a plugin, but it doesn't really integrate well into the ecosystem. For example, you'll have to create Samba shares yourself via config file rather than the GUI. Or you can just wait till Lime Technologies releases a new version of Unraid with ZFS support. Any day now. And if you run TrueNAS, you're obviously going to want to go with ZFS. But there's also the third option. You can go with a regular Linux distro like Ubuntu or Debian and use Mergerfs with Snapraid. Mergerfs is a piece of software that lets you combine multiple disks into one. I think the best part of Mergerfs is that there are no RAID shenanigans happening under the hood. The files are simply being written to the drives directly, and if you take one drive out of the array and connect it to a different computer, you'll be able to read the files written to it, similar to how an unRAID hard drive array works. Just like BTRFS, you can use different sized drives or add drives to the array after the fact. But Mergerfs goes further and lets you add drives that already have data on them. And that's because Mergerfs isn't an actual file system. You don't have to format your drives in Mergerfs before using them in an array, since Mergerfs is really just a software tool that combines multiple pre-formatted drives into one for convenience sake. Of course, just writing the data to the drives with no parity wouldn't be super safe, so in order to have some sort of redundancy, we can use Snapraid. Snapraid is another piece of software that takes your disk array, calculates parity data for it, and writes it to a separate drive. The parity data is hashed to ensure data integrity, and if you lose a drive, you can then replace it and recover the data by using a Snapraid fix command. Moreover, Snapraid actually lets you recover deleted files on your drives and exclude entire folders from parity. That way, if you have a relatively large folder that you don't care about, let's say a downloads folder or something, your parity drive doesn't even have to be as big as the biggest drive in your array. The only problem I see with that dangerous duo is that both Snapraid and Mergerfs are much more niche than ZFS or BTRFS, and probably haven't been battle tested to the same extent as these two, but that's just a speculation. Mergerfs GitHub page has a small tutorial on how to implement tiered caching, and I'm also going to put a helpful script from a GitHub user Elmus down in the description. The script basically moves all the files from your SSD cache to the hard drive array when your SSD array reaches a defined free space threshold, and you can specify how old the files need to be in order to be moved, or how full your disks need to be. Unfortunately, I don't know if tiered caching is possible in ZFS, since I've only tried TrueNAS briefly. Theoretically, there is level 2 ARC and ZIL, but that's not quite the same as tiered caching, since your hard drives will still need to be spinning during the file transfers, so that does nothing to fix the issues with power consumption and noise that hard drives create. You could of course create two separate ZFS pools and let something like Mergerfs take care of the tiered storage part, but at this point the ZFS nerds will probably use advanced witchcraft to find your location, knock down your door and turn you into a frog. I use Unraid, and one of the good things about Unraid is that it provides a super easy way for you to set up your cache pool. First, you need to stop your array and add a new cache pool. Then add your SSD to the cache pool and start the array. After that, we're going to format the new drives, and then I'm going to go to the cache pool settings and set the RAID mode to RAID 5, because I like to live dangerously. Now we can go to each of our share settings, set the cache pool to the one that we've just created, and set the cache mode to yes. Now when you write data to the share with something like NFS or Samba, the data should be written to the cache pool. But what happens when the cache array is full? Well, Unraid has a little script called mover that takes care of exactly that. Let's go to settings, scheduler, and take a look at the mover settings. Out of the box, there aren't really that many settings, so I suggest you install a plugin called CA Mover Tuning. After that, you should see more settings in the scheduler section. Here you can specify how often you want to run the mover, as well as a bunch of other settings, such as space threshold at which the mover should run, the access times of files that should be moved, and so on. These are the settings that I use. Feel free to copy them or use the default settings instead and customize them based on your needs. You can test your new cache pool by copying something over to your NAS and taking a look at the transfer speed. I'm gonna go further and actually test my cache pool with Amorphous Disk Mark, which is basically a clone of Crystal Disk Mark for macOS. As you can see, I'm getting upwards of 1000 MB per second reads and around 250 MB per second writes. And here I am editing this very video off of the SSD cache of my NAS. Epilepsy warning, everyone. So there you have it. We've set up a monstrous 8 TB cache array on my Unraid server, and hopefully my ramblings about networking, file systems, and other stuff have been somewhat helpful. So that's gonna be it for this video, and as usual, I would like to thank my patrons. Carlos Banilla, David Love, James Uppington, Catherine DC, Mitchell Valentino, Primus, Remus Ilyesh, Robots Dream of Crypto, and everyone else supports this channel. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.